Thank you for joining today's webinar, Innovative Practices in Medication-Assisted Treatment and Primary Care Coordination. June Savilli, Chief of the Treatment Branch for the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy, will provide instructions. And later on, Bob Lubrin, Director of Division of Pharmaceutical Therapies at SAMHSA, will facilitate the Q&A. Good afternoon, June.
Good afternoon, Colin. Thanks so much. Good afternoon. My name is June Savilli. I'm the Chief of the Treatment Branch in the Office of Demand Reduction in the Office of National Drug Control Policy. Thank you for registering for today's webinar. And special thanks, of course, go to our presenters from Maryland, Dr. Ken Stoller, and Rhode Island's Dr. Susan Storti. Today we will hear about two different models of care in which medication-assisted treatment is provided and addiction care is integrated with health care. Both of our presenters will be speaking on their own behalf and not on behalf of the federal government. Now I'd like to introduce Director of ONDCP, Mr. Michael Botticelli, who will provide some opening remarks. Mr. Botticelli joined the agency in November 2012 as the Deputy Director and then served as the Acting Director. He was sworn in as the ONDCP Director on February 11, 2015. Prior to coming to ONDCP, Mr. Botticelli served as the Director of the Bureau of Substance Abuse Services in the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. In 2008, he became the first recipient of the annual Ramsted Kennedy National Award for Outstanding Leadership in Promoting Addiction Recovery. Director Botticelli, I now turn it over to you.
Thank you, June, for that introduction. And I'm sorry for those folks on the line who have heard that more than a million times. But I really want to thank everybody for being today. We had an extraordinary response to this webinar. And I also want to thank our two presenters today. I think, you know, the response here is a function of, I think, all of us looking at ways to not only expand medication-assisted treatment and primary care, but how all of us are responding to the extraordinary opioid epidemic that we have. And I really appreciate your models of your work and your interest in this area. Next slide, please. So for those of you who don't know, this is another slide that I'm sure you've seen way too many times. But the Office of National Drug Control Policy, we are a component of the Executive Office of the President, and we have some main functions that we produce the National Drug Control Strategy. And our strategy is really focused on an intergovernmental response to issues of drug use and its consequences in the United States. We work with our interagency partners to set the National Drug Control Strategy and also to set our National Drug Control Budget in partnership with our federal agency. I think many of you know that we have been continuing to focus on the public health aspects of this disease and how we continue to work with both law enforcement and public health entities for a balanced approach to drug policy in the United States. I'm happy to say that when you look at the overall budget for the national drug control spending, that our federal funding for prevention, treatment, and recovery services is at the highest point in the history of our office. And I think this demonstrates the administration's commitment to dealing with this problem. Next slide, please. Our strategy is really based on four main components. That one, preventing drug use before it ever begins through education and evidence-based prevention programs. Clearly, expanding access to treatment for Americans who struggle with this addiction is incredibly important. Third, reforming our criminal justice system and making sure that we are diverting people away from arrest and incarceration, get access to treatment, but also making sure that people have good treatment behind the walls and have good reentry services upon release. And that lastly, supporting Americans in recovery is really fundamental to our overall reform of drug policy. Our strategy has 112 action items that June is responsible for all of them. Part of this is, again, that this is how we monitor our progress toward meeting our. We've had a number of signature initiatives, including prescription drug abuse prevention and drug driving. All of you on this webinar, I think, know that we are at a critical point in the care and delivery of people with substance use disorders and have many opportunities before us to really look at transitioning treatment and care from an acute care model to a chronic care model. And there are lots of things that are happening now that we'll talk about in a minute that really look at this. But I think all of you know that, you know, addiction is a disease that's often left to progress to its most acute phase before we intervene, and that really treatment has largely focused on dealing with the acute phase of this disorder, and really focuses on someone entering treatment, they receive treatment, and they're discharged, and that's often how we kind of monitor sometimes our effectiveness of treatment. But we're really moving toward a chronic care model, one that identifies prevention as a critical component of our work, of early intervention. How do we make sure that people who are exhibiting problematic use and might be progressing to a substance use disorder have opportunities within a wide variety of settings, but particularly healthcare settings, to do early intervention like we do with other diseases? We clearly support a wide variety of evidence-based substance use disorder treatment services. And again, I think all of us who've been involved in this work are excited about kind of our growing body of evidence about effective care and treatment, but also recovery support services. And how do we ensure that people are, that our goals of getting people to long-term recovery is really our ultimate objective in what we're trying to do, and that obviously treatment is an important role for many people, but ongoing care, recovery supports are clearly important for people to maintain their recovery. Next slide, please. All of you, I'm sure, have seen this slide before. You know, hopefully over the next couple of years, we'll see these figures dramatically change. I think you know that despite the fact that substance use disorders has roughly the prevalence of diabetes, which has a treatment rate of about 80%, that substance use disorders, unfortunately, only about 11% of people who meet diagnostic criteria for a substance use disorder receive specialty treatment. Our work here is clearly how do we increase that access to care. And we know that there are significant opportunities with the ACA and other initiatives of how we can increase that work. I think it's also important to know that when you look at TEDS data on referral sources to treatment, that one of the biggest referral sources to treatment is our criminal justice system. And what that says is that, unfortunately, we are not doing a good job of either identifying people, particularly in healthcare settings, who may be exhibiting problems with behavior or need referral to a specialty treatment. Next slide, please. So this is not an exhaustive list, but I want to talk a little bit about kind of how ONDCP, as well as our federal partners, are really working to expand access to evidence-based treatment services. You know, and I'll start at the kind of bottom of the list, and we clearly know the opportunities that we have with the Affordable Care Act, as well as the implementation of parity laws, to ensure that people have adequate care and coverage for their disorder. We know one of the main reasons why people don't get care and people who seek care don't get care is not having insurance coverage or having insurance coverage that doesn't fully support addiction treatment services. So clearly we have the opportunity, and I think we're already seeing increased access to treatment because of people and increased care and coverage. What's not up here are some of the recent funding initiatives that the federal government has undertaken to increase access to treatment, and particularly increase access to treatment for medication-assisted therapies and in healthcare settings. I think many of you have seen the announcement that came out a few weeks ago, a grant announcement from the Health Resources Services Administration that announced $100 million to support expansion of substance use treatment services and particularly medication-assisted treatment within our federally qualified healthcare system. So I hope you all take advantage of that, as well as SAMHSA grants announced to support state-level grants for expanded access to medication-assisted treatment. We've also been working with our federal partners through our treatment coordination group to really leverage federal policy and resources to increase awareness of and use of medication-assisted treatment throughout federal government. Many of you might be involved with state policy teams that have been focusing particularly on dealing with the opioid epidemic. But we've been working with the National Governors Association, with ASTO, and state policy teams to look at how state efforts can augment federal resources and federal policy to expand medication-assisted therapies for the treatment of substance use disorders. Clearly, our role is to promote medication-assisted treatment, and when I say that, I'm including behavioral and recovery support therapies as part of that work of really ensuring that that is the standard of care. Clearly, our work with health plans and pharmacy organizations to offer adequate coverage for screening and treatment is important to our work, as well as our work with CMS to work with states to ensure adequate health benefits, including MAT. So I think we are seeing some significant improvements. We have a ways to go, but of coverage and access to medications for the treatment of substance use disorders. Next slide. One of the areas of great progress that we've made is the continued development of medications for, and I'm focused particularly on opioid use disorders, that we now have an armamentarium of medications to deal with opioid use disorders. It's very clear from all of the evidence that people with opioid use disorders who are on medications, again, with other behavioral and recovery supports, do far better than those people with opioid use disorders who are not on medication. So clearly, we know that those medications are important. We also know that those medications are important to diminish some of the other consequences of opioid use disorders, including overdose and infectious disease reduction, which I think many of you are experiencing. So I'm really pleased that we will continue to promote these models and other models that support integration of medications within primary care settings. Next slide. I'll just finish with this. You know, one of the opportunities that we have, you know, I'm sure many of you have been in many, many meetings over the past couple of years as it relates to the opioid epidemic, and continue to hear the role that stigma plays in delaying people's accessing care, and also a barrier for people seeking care. So while insurance coverage is critical, we have to create an environment that is supportive of people seeking care. And one of those areas that we can focus on and have some real effect is the language that we use to talk about addiction, and particularly as we talk about some of the language around medication-assisted treatment, which I think is particularly important. We have been working with many others to look at changing our language that has a highly stigmatizing effect. So things like addict and junkie and substance abuser, we know have highly stigmatizing effects. John Kelly and colleagues at the Massachusetts General Hospital and the Recovery Research Institute published some recent research that gave trained clinicians near identical scenarios of someone with a substance use disorder. And the only piece about the vignettes that they altered was in one they referred to the person as a substance abuser, and then the other one, a person with a substance use disorder. And what they found is that when, even among trained clinicians, when you called someone a substance abuser, it elicited a much more punitive response than when we talk about someone as having a substance use disorder. I will also call your attention to some of the language that we've historically used as it relates to urine drug screens for substance use disorders. And I think we are beginning to make sure that we not use kind of highly judgmental language as it relates to particularly urine drug screens. So I want to, again, thank you all for being on this call today. and for participating, and thank our presenters. You can continue to look forward to our continued promotion of highly effective models that increase access to care, and particularly increase our capacity within primary care settings to deal with not only the stigma of seeking care, but providing really holistic coverage for people with substance use disorders. So thanks, everybody, for being here today.
Thank you for those opening remarks, Director. I want to inform our listeners that Director Botticelli will turn the rest of the webinar over to our presenters and will not be with us for the remainder of the webinar. And now I'd like to introduce our first presenter, Dr. Kenneth Stoller. Dr. Stoller is an assistant professor of psychiatry and behavioral sciences at Johns Hopkins. He has served as the medical director of addiction treatment services at the Hopkins Bayview program until 2009, when he became director of the Johns Hopkins Broadway Center for Addiction. Before we begin, I'd like to remind participants that questions will be addressed during the question and answer session that will take place after all presentations have been completed. And Dr. Stoller will now begin. And just as a reminder, Ken, please say next slide when you would like to proceed so that Colin, AT&T operator, can advance the slides for our participants.
Thanks so much, June, for that introduction. I'm really delighted to join this group of speakers, and my part of this will be to describe an integrated treatment model I've been using at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, which links our opioid treatment program with nearby office-based buprenorphine prescribers to expand capacity while also improving the quality of care. So this is a model of clinical integration, which in brief seeks to coordinate elements of care in order to maximize the value of services delivered. There's various ways of integrating care. There's possibilities of having single location, multiple locations, single or multiple provider entities. Next slide, please. And today we'll be talking about a collaborative model because we have multiple locations. We have the OTP and then multiple OBOT or office-based opioid treatment providers. And they're operating in different locations and they're more than one entity. Next slide. What this really depends on is the role of the OTP, the Opioid Treatment Program, as a hub of expertise and service. And for, I think, too long, OTPs have largely functioned without a lot of formal linkages to other parts of the addiction treatment system or the medical or mental health treatment system. I think that has largely due to issues related to stigma. And I think we've started to move past that and have been missing a critical opportunity until now. Next slide. So especially now in this age, in terms of a overall response to the public health crisis, it's really important to get medication-assisted therapies out there. This just illustrates a plea by Dr. Clark, at the time director of the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment, for physicians to, if you're not using your waiver or not treating as many patients as you could, to go ahead and do so. Next slide. Buprenorphine continues to be underutilized. There's a couple of studies here that I've cited. One is a national study done by Wendy Kissen and colleagues that showed that only 58% of physicians who received their waivers actually prescribed at all. Barriers identified included the logistics of induction being seen as difficult, the potential for poor compliance among this population, and limited counseling that they might have in their office-based practice. In Maryland, there's a study that was done as well that had very similar results, looking at 330 waivered physicians, and again, only 50% were actively prescribing, and the barriers were similar with the thought that effective treatment is both difficult and time-consuming. And what I would say is that in the setting of an office-based practice and with patients that have complex needs and multiple substance use disorders, it can be difficult and time-consuming. Next slide. So this is really where I think that OTPs can step up and really be part of this solution and encourage physicians to get waivers by supporting the physician practices. And so I list here the three concerns that I really heard the most of when I am talking with these providers in the community. One is that the initial assessment is time-consuming and somewhat strange for somebody perhaps who hasn't really done much in terms of behavioral health treatment. Then the induction can be initially intimidating if they haven't done it before. There might be fears of putting somebody in precipitated withdrawal. And then instability. You know, what do we do? How do I handle a patient if I can't get them stabilized? Or what if they stabilize but then later on they relapse? How do I get them to go to treatment? What do I do with them? How is that going to affect my office practice? Next slide. So the OTP can really step up by being a hub with spokes out to the OBOT providers and really providing the support that physicians feel they need in order to comfortably provide this service. Next slide. So this is why I created this collaborative opioid prescribing, or I coined it the co-op model of treatment. And the purpose is to both increase the availability of treatment by having more physicians feel comfortable in getting their waivers and starting to use their waivers and treating more patients on their waivers, but at the same time increasing the effectiveness of office-based buprenorphine. And we do that through concurrent treatment at the OTP using counseling services and other supportive care, collaborative step care model that I'll review in just a second, and expert consultation with the OTP clinical leadership. Next slide. So on this next slide are the components of this model. One is that there's concurrent treatment between in both the OTP as well as the office-based opioid treatment buprenorphine prescriber. There's a comprehensive assessment that's done typically at the OTP, and at the end of that assessment, it's determined, first of all, is this person a candidate for any medication-assisted therapy, and then if so, which one? We are so fortunate to have three effective medications for opioid use disorder, and through a good comprehensive assessment, it can be determined which ones would be most recommended, and then, of course, taking into account the patient's preferences, it's determined which of these medications can be helpful. Most of my presentation will focus on buprenorphine specifically, but I just want to point out that the use of these medications, whether to use them on, when to use it, and which ones to use over time, really should be dynamic and assessed over time. We shouldn't define treatment by a medication that somebody is using. The buprenorphine induction and then initial stabilization is done at my OTP. And then once they're stabilized, they have one or two drug negative urines and they're coming to their counseling sessions on a regular basis. Then we shift them to get prescriptions at the OBOT physician as opposed to getting their medication daily at our dispensary. However, we continue with ongoing counseling and monitoring through urine toxicology at our OTP. Next slide. It's really important, as always, for these sorts of collaborative models to have ongoing communication between the OTP and the OBOT provider. And this model is really, it's an adaptive step care model. It's really based on the model that was developed by Dr. Robert Bruner at Johns Hopkins that focused on the model of treatment to be used within the OTP. It's considered the gold standard as far as the structure of OTP treatment. But this expands then this model, now encompassing office-based buprenorphine prescribers as well. We use treatment adherence, so counseling attendance, and measures of substance use, so our toxicology results, to determine the step of care, which defines the counseling intensity, the prescribing duration, so whether somebody's getting a month versus a week worth of medication at a time, and then periods of time where we can take back the dispensing at our OTP in order to better monitor the patient during periods of destabilization. Ultimately, the expectation is that our participants, our patients, are fully engaged in treatment and at least provide some periods of time where they're able to provide drug-free. If they really struggle and they don't respond to this and they continue to be poorly engaged, we offer them a switch to methadone, and some people just need that full agonist for treatment. And if they need something else, let's say they meet ACM criteria for a residential level of care, then we can make that referral. If ultimately they are responding poorly and are refusing to engage in treatment, then we offer them an AMA Suboxone taper. Next slide. So this next slide has these steps in a tabular fashion, and the grayed out areas, those gray boxes, are the steps up in care. So in step one, they're doing well, they're on buprenorphine through prescribing in the office-based practice, maybe a month at a time, and we have low intensity of counseling services, anywhere from maybe once per month to twice per week services. If they destabilize, we can then increase their counseling service at the OTP so that they have an intensive outpatient level of care. And in Maryland, that's 9 or more hours of treatment scheduled per week. And we'd recommend to the buprenorphine prescriber to decrease their prescriptions to maybe 1 week at a time. If they stabilize, they move back down to step one. And if they don't, or if they continue to destabilize, then we can escalate treatment further by now taking over the dispensing of the medication daily through our OTP. And that really allows us to monitor the patient a lot more closely, deliver positive messages, positive reinforcement, and to reinforce their attendance to their counseling. So, for example, we would not provide the medication until they have finished their day's worth of If they stabilize and move back down, if they don't stabilize, as I said, we can offer them methadone treatment. Next slide. So in any sort of endeavor like this where there's more work involved, in any sort of collaborative effort, there's more work, it's important that everybody is incentivized. So we're incentivized because this generates more patient volume through referrals from primary care sites. And likewise, we have more prescribers to refer to when we have patients who we would like to, who we think are candidates for office-based buprenorphine. In addition, there's, and this is really important, and not something that I went into this really knowing would be a benefit. It's been really great to develop these relationships with medical providers and have these ongoing communications, initially about the medication, the buprenorphine, but ultimately then we have more conversations about the person's complex co-occurring conditions and can better treat this very complex population. Next slide. I'm going to quickly go through a case example here next, and what I missed this slide. Okay, I'm still waiting on the slide. Here we go. I'll just start talking. The OBOT prescriber is incentivized because now they have a patient with addiction that's being addressed. And actually, I think if they know that this addiction can be addressed, they'd be more likely to try to detect it. The buprenorphine provision now is really with support and ready access to expertise, and I regularly have these providers emailing me or calling me and asking for some advice and support. And through doing this and through stabilization of the substance use disorder, the patients now can have improved medical adherence and decreased morbidity and certainly mortality. As far as the patients that I'm treating, I don't regularly track mortality rates because they're so infrequently, but we hear about some past patients passing away at times, and I'd say on average we may have 1 to 2 current patients that pass away per year, but almost all from chronic medical problems as opposed to overdoses. Next slide. We've been tracking some numbers of patients treated through this model since 2011. When I got here, actually in 2009, if a person got a buprenorphine provider on the outside, they'd be discharged from our program. So we immediately stopped doing that and started tracking these patients. And since then, we've had 81 patients receiving buprenorphine from 22 external providers. We have a relatively small clinic. Our total clinic number is about 170. And we treat all substances of abuse. It doesn't have to be OD. Next slide, please. So the next slide begins a case example, and I want you to pay attention mainly to the pink box that's going to be bouncing up and down through this table. And what that's going to indicate is movement between steps. And it's really this sort of dynamic changing between levels of care that could be very important for the person's recovery. It's really during those transitions that some of the most intensive opportunities for learning can take place. So this is a 54-year-old woman admitted for opiate and cocaine dependence and had a number of medical problems as well. We admitted her, inducted her onto the buprenorphine medication, and started her initially on intensive outpatient counseling because of her level of problems. Next slide. She actually stabilized pretty quickly, and we were able to decrease her to step two. Within a couple of weeks, her primary care provider took over prescribing. Next slide. And then within just a couple of weeks later, she continued to be stable, and we decreased her counseling intensity to a low level. The other great thing about this model is that we're using the least intensive level of care, and that's something that's also very acceptable to payers. Next slide. Of course, relapse happens, and this person came up positive for cocaine at her toxicology at the OTP, and despite an excuse that she made, we still intensified her care to intensive outpatient in step two. Next slide. So she actually stabilized within a month of treatment. She had negative toxicology and had good attendance to treatment, so we reduced her counseling again. Next slide. You'll see in the next slide that she had another relapse, and in addition to being positive on toxicology, she also had an issue with let's go to the next one more slide too. Thank you. With failing a buprenorphine recall, so we actually transferred her about a month later to the OTP for dosing. Next slide. The good thing about that also, dosing in the OTP, is not only that we can monitor better and we can provide more support, but also it acts as a negative reinforcer because people really do want to get back to prescribing through the office. It's been a very, it's been very good in terms of patient acceptance. And so they like having their prescriptions through their primary care doctor. So her toxicology screened, and she went back to step one, and she did well for quite a long time after that. Next slide. So our early experience is that we were able to successfully partner with office-based and primarily primary care providers in the community. And so this increased the access to MAT for our own patients here in our substance abuse treatment program and even for people needing those services in the community, more waivered physicians and greater use of their waivers. There's enhanced primary care coordination, and that's good for our patients' health. And then we've managed to rapidly and effectively manage relapse when it occurs. Next slide. Some of the keys to success here has been to make sure that all parties are incentivized. I involved the leadership of these primary care practices very early on so that they can then push their providers to get their waivers and to start utilizing them. Maintaining communication, of course, is always key. And in terms of that, establishing a single point of contact within each of those primary care sites has been great. So if we want to refer somebody to the primary care site for office-based medication, then we can email or call this one particular person, and then they can schedule those appointments with any number of providers that they have. We're really lucky in the state of Maryland that we have a very progressive reimbursement system, and I understand that not all states have that. And most of our patients have Medicaid, and in Maryland, all these necessary services are reimbursed, including a bundled rate for buprenorphine or methadone delivery as a weekly bundled rate to the OTP. There's a separate payment per dose of buprenorphine dispensed at the OTP, an intensive outpatient bundle at a daily rate, and then rates for group and individual sessions for patients in an ACM level 1 traditional outpatient care. For uninsured patients or those with only Medicare, they could be treated under our block grant. So the last thing that I've learned is that it's really important to dispel myths. And we have in our clinic people who are on MAT. Well, first of all, we have people who have opiate use disorder or alcohol use disorder or any other substance use disorder. Of those with opioid use disorder, some on MAT, some on various medications, sometimes on, sometimes off. There's never a problem with this. There's no standing up and finger pointing and accusing somebody of not being in recovery. So it just hasn't been a problem, and I just need to point that out, and I think it's important to dispel those sorts of myths. Next slide. So future directions I'd like to see. First of all, I'd love to see what happens elsewhere in terms of other possible co-op models. The model that I showed is just one example, and it fits our patient population in our state, and you know, any number of changes to that can be made to meet the patient's needs in the sorts of considering the logistics in various states. And speaking of that, we actually have a what's called a mini grant through the Provider Clinical Support System and AAAP and ATOD that's looking at disseminating this model to 20 or 25 OTPs throughout the country to see what how that goes in terms of being able to establish these sorts of models and providing those programs some support. So if anybody that's participating today would like to be involved with that, please contact me, and if we have any more slots, I can point you in the right direction. I'd love to see this extended to other settings. I've done some of this already in terms of treating people in mental health and in the HIV clinic at Johns Hopkins. I think there's other opportunities, for example, in obstetric practices. And then finally, establishing metrics for success. So I'd love to be able to see you know, numbers of prescribers, patients treated, ease of access, and importantly, the satisfaction of the providers and patients. And what I'd say is that our experience so far has been very positive. One heartwarming thing has been when I've been talking to the residents and fellows at Hopkins who are rotating through one of our teaching primary care facilities, they're loving this. They're learning about buprenorphine, they're ready to use it, and they're really appreciative to have the experience of being able to do this with their preceptors and do it in a way that they see is really works really well. They're not just writing prescriptions for a month and then having the patient disappear. So that's all I have. I'll end at this point. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Stoller, for that excellent presentation. Now I'd like to introduce our second presenter, Dr. Susan Stoorty. Dr. Stoorty is the Statewide Opioid Treatment Program Health Home Administrative Coordinator in the state of Rhode Island. Prior to this, she was the project director for the National Institute on Drug Abuse Blending Research and Practice Initiative and principal investigator and director for the Addiction Technology Transfer Center of New England at Brown University's Center for Alcohol and Addiction Studies. She has been working in this field for over 25 years. Just as a reminder, Dr. Stoorty, please say next slide when you'd like to proceed so the AT&T operator can advance the slides for our participants. Take it away.
Thank you. Thank you for the introduction and for the opportunity to share what we are doing here in Rhode Island. Next slide, please. Opioid abuse remains one of the most significant drug threats to the New England region as a whole, with Rhode Island historically having a higher percentage of heroin users than the national average. And as you can see, demonstrated by this slide, is we have an increasing number of treatment episodes. So, of course, as treatment admission rates for heroin and prescription opioid pain relievers increase, so does the treatment demand. Next slide, please. When CMS invited the states to submit state plan amendments, the Department of Behavioral Health Developmental Disabilities and Hospitals saw this as an opportunity to work collaboratively with our Opioid Treatment Association of Rhode Island, which is comprised of five organizations all providing opioid treatment services, mostly methadone. So they did develop an application, they submitted it, and subsequently it was approved in 2013. Next slide, please. The statewide collaborative model that was designed was really designed to do a number of things, certainly to decrease stigma, to monitor chronic conditions, and to enhance the coordination of physical care and the treatment of opioid dependence. As I said, there are five providers throughout the state. We have 12 clinics also located throughout the state. As you will notice on this map, the majority of the clinics are located along the perimeter of the state. The interior section, or what I would tell you is the more rural areas of our state, we don't have programs there. However, we are moving toward the development of a pilot program to link some of our waived physicians with the OTP health homes, and I'll discuss this in further detail just a little occasion. Next slide, please. So the OTP health home is free to Medicaid and RICARE recipients who are currently receiving and or meet the criteria for MAT, for opioid dependence. Our program is designed as an auto-assignment with an option to opt out. And I would tell you that up to this point, we've had about 22% of our patients who have opted out, with the common reasons most often cited as duplication of services, feeling that they are stable and not really having any needs, they have other insurance, they may be on take-home status, or there's just a total lack of engagement and a resistance to change. We began our health home program on October 1st of 2013, and at that point it was we had about 1,500 patients that we had identified that were eligible to participate. Between October 1st, 2013 and October 1st of 2014, we actually experienced a 52% increase in the number of individuals entering into our health home program. It's important to bear in mind here that on January 1 of 2014, Medicaid expansion came into play, which really did bump our numbers up significantly. Currently, our numbers have stabilized between 2,600 and 2,650. I should also tell you that over the course of the duration from October of 2013, we have had 28 of our patients who have died. Six as a result of overdose, a combination of other drugs and or medications with methadone. With the remaining 22 as a result of other chronic medical conditions such as cardiovascular disease, complications of COPD, complications of diabetes, kidney failure, and so on. So our hope is that for those individuals who unfortunately have passed this type of program, we're able to identify those types of chronic conditions earlier and link them with primary health care much sooner. Next slide, please. So who provides our health home services? We have a health home team. Our team is made up of a master's level team leader, a physician, nurse, two case managers, one who has a specific task of working as a hospital liaison, as well as a pharmacist. Initially, the teams were designed that there would be one team that would provide services for 125 patients. However, what we have found based on our experiences is that we have actually adjusted the number of patients that each team is responsible for, and that's really been based on our patient acuity levels, which I will talk about in just 1 minute. We also share three collaborative positions, the first being the role that I am in, the administrative coordinator, the second being what we originally thought would be an HIT coordinator's position, but upon reexamination, what we determined that hiring an IT company to assist us in infrastructure development would really better address our needs. And then we have a training coordinator because we recognize that the skill set of the workforce was going to vary. And so in an effort to provide optimum care, we have designed workforce development activities to ensure that all staff are trained with a particular focus on the provision of a holistic person-centered care within a recovery-oriented system of care. Next slide, please. As I previously stated, we have this substantial increase in the number of patients entering into the program over a very, very short period of time, many of them with complex needs. So in an effort to address this, what I decided to do is take a look at the medical and the nursing literature to examine patient triage and staffing models across a variety of settings. That actually resulted in the establishment of these three-level of patient acuity. Next slide, please. We have further now developed this into a tool, and I'm sorry, I realize that the slide doesn't, you can't really see it because it's small, but I just wanted to give you a sense of sort of what it looks like. It's a checklist, and this checklist really contains a number of what we would consider low or moderate risk factors, which is our level one, our level two, which are our high risk patients, and our level three, which are those individuals who have chronic conditions, however, are maintained. It's important for me to say at this point that the way this particular patient acuity model was established was to provide flexibility. So if, for instance, a patient who has had COPT that has been well maintained for a period of time all of a sudden ended up in the hospital because of some type of respiratory infection, they would be literally moved from level one down to a level two, understanding that upon discharge they would probably need more care coordination until they restabilized, and then they would move back up to a level three designation. Next slide, please. By looking at the patient acuity levels, it really has also provided the OTP health home leadership with the tool to better utilize the skill set of the existing staff, deliver quality services in a cost-effective manner, but also assist in the decision-making regarding when additional staff might be hired or should be hired. So what you have before you is really a snapshot of the total patient population in the various levels of patient acuity. And at any given time, you will have anywhere from 13 to 44% of our patient population at level 1, 28 to 58% at level 2, and 9 to 48% at level 3. Quite often, the variation in the percentages is secondary to the geographic location of the clinic within the state, as well as the number of patients obviously being served within that specific clinic setting. Next slide, please. Quite often when I speak about the OTP health home, I'm asked about the rate that each of the OTPs are paid on a weekly basis. So I'm including this slide because I think it's important for you to understand how the rate was determined. So right now, our OTP health homes are receiving $137.52 on a weekly combined health home rate and opioid treatment service rate. What's really important here is that July 1st of 2015, was the start of when we finished our 24 months of the pilot, if you will. And the state of Rhode Island has agreed, at least for the immediate future, to continue the program in its current configuration in terms of staffing model at the same health home rate. Next slide, please. We have just started to examine our Medicaid expenditure data, both at an individual and an aggregate level. And I can tell you that at this point, our preliminary analyses are showing a significant downward trend. However, I say that with caution, given the fact that, you know, we're looking at truly a snapshot beginning of October 1, 2013 through June 30th of 2015. So our plan is to re-examine the data at the end of December. At that point, our hope is that, you know, we'll have a more robust data set to take a look at. I can tell you that by doing the preliminary analysis, at least to this point, we have been able to identify the high utilizers of our emergency rooms, which is now leading to the development of a collaborative working arrangement with United Healthcare. They are bringing their behavioral health and medical teams in to meet with our OTP health home teams, all in an effort to enhance service delivery and care coordination. Next slide, please. In addition to the three goals, In addition to the three goals set forth by CMS, there are some additional data points that we are also collecting, as you can see on the slide. And as I said earlier, when we recognized all of the information that we needed to gather, we decided to go with an IT company, and the name of that company is Brave River Solutions. The Department of Behavioral Health, as well as the OTP Health Home staff and Brave River, all sat down, and we actually designed a web-based database so that we could collect these data elements. Next slide, please. It is a custom application that has established a central point for our data collection for our OTPs. And what you see before you is sort of a snapshot of what our homepage looks like. Next slide, please. All of the aggregate data will be able to be seen. The program provides a structure that allows for reporting not only as an individual organization, but also as a total aggregate or one entity. Next slide, please. And while the database was not completed until October 24th, which has resulted in a delay in uploading all of the data. However, I can tell you that the OTP Health Home staff are quickly catching up, and our goal is to have all the quarters uploaded by October 2015. This particular database will allow us to either look at the data, we can also look at the data on an individual patient level as well as at the organizational and aggregate level. Next slide, please. As a mechanism to drive further program development and implementation, we implemented a patient satisfaction survey, which was conducted between November and December of 2014, which was the one-year mark. And overall, you know, we had a response rate of 24.3%. And when the survey was designed, it was designed to examine three different domains: patient experience, satisfaction, and engagement, because we felt that those were the areas that we were really focusing on with this particular initiative. Overall, patients were satisfied with the services that they were receiving, with the coordination of the care. And what was most striking for all of us was that 88% agreed that they would follow through if referred to a provider at a clinic for care, which, as you know, if you work with this particular population, that's very unusual. As Dr. Stoller and Director Botticelli have already stated, the secondary to the stigma associated with their substance use disorder, they very seldom do not access health care as needed. Next slide, please. Additionally, we wanted to really acquire knowledge on the patient's perceptions of care and their health care experiences, so we held focus groups at each of the clinics. And as a result, what we found was that overall they, again, were pleased with the program as it helped them to establish a connection to healthcare, and they felt as though it was really helping them to learn about self-care and management, that it provided a safe and caring environment, and that it was for recovery. So in addition to the identification of the common themes, the participants were also asked to offer suggestions regarding how to improve the program. So these suggestions, along with the results of the satisfaction survey and the focus groups, as well as the audits that have been performed by the Department of Behavioral Health, are all serving as a basis for the development of quality and improvement plans at each of the OTPs. Next slide, please. So as we, you know, continue to look for ways to expand services, we are also involved in two initiatives, one involving buprenorphine and the other Vivitrol. Next slide, please. So as I previously mentioned, we lack programs sort of in the interior or rural areas of our state. So in an effort to increase that access, we are in the process of developing a two-pronged pilot program, both utilizing components of Dr. Stoller's Stepped care approach, as well as the Vermont hub and spoke model, where the health homes will link with not only the community-based WAVID physicians, but we're also looking to link with WAVID physicians located within the FQHCs. As a result of this, United has expressed interest in working with us. So as we go forward in the design of this approach, Dr. Stola has graciously agreed to provide us guidance. Next slide, please. With regard to Vivitrol, the Rhode Island Adult Correctional Institute is really part of the Rhode Island Department of Corrections, which is a state agency operating, obviously, the state prisons. At this point, we have been working with the pre-release coordinator there. They have a program that they're just in the process of beginning to implement where Alkermes, which is the pharmaceutical control, is providing staff training and has agreed to pay for the first dose of Vivitrol pre-release. And both insurers, United and Neighborhood Health, have agreed to pay for the medication for individuals as part of the overdose prevention program. We are currently designing a pilot to have a member of the OTP Health Home actually become part of the pre-release planning team at the Adult Correctional Institute, so that upon release, the individual will receive their health home services, counseling, medication monitoring, will all be administered by the OTP health home staff. We're at the point now where we're examining policies and procedures and starting to figure out protocols. Next slide, please. So in terms of highlights, I would say that we have successfully implemented the health home program in 12 clinics across the state, and that we are currently providing services to more than 2,600 patients. By the developing the patient acuity model and overlaying it over the existing population, we really have been able to tailor the care being provided to patient need. We have developed and or enhanced the collaborative working relationships, not only with our managed care entities, but certainly with our community health centers, our community mental health organizations, private practitioners, recovery services, et cetera. We have developed a statewide educational consultative network, which basically it's starting slowly, but it's physicians to physicians, nurses to nurses. For instance, we have had surgeons contacting our OTP health home physicians asking for guidance in terms of, you know, we have a shared patient who's going to require surgery, you know, how do we medicate pre and post-op, exchange of education and wonderful learning opportunities. We have also been meeting with the dentists throughout the state, trying to bring them on board as well. And in addition to that, we have some other additional pilot programs at clinics. One has added acupuncture into the health home treatment services, and that has been very, very well received. We also have another agency who is initiating home visits. And I am happy to say that we also have the first CARF-accredited OTP health home in the United States. Next slide, please. So what I will say is while we have made great strides and are making a difference, we continuously look for new ways to build upon the existing infrastructure in an effort to expand access to service, reduce duplication, and really maximize cost effectiveness. So thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Storti, for that really great presentation. I think that we're going to move on to the question and answer period, and I just want to mention we do have a little bit of time still. They're not going to cut off our webinar, so if there are people still listening, we have time for a couple of questions. I think we'll go until about 4:15. So if there's so operator, please open the lines.
It sounds like there's a lot of good work going on. I applaud the people that did the presentations and encourage them to continue with their activities. I'm an emergency medicine physician, so I tend to deal with a lot of these things in the emergency department. But, you know, the payor is not the government, and it is not some anonymous third-party big bad insurance company. It is you and me, we the people. It is our tax dollars or our overpaid health care insurance premiums that pay for all of this stuff. So I guess, you know, although this has been a great presentation, it is a little bit like a marketing, sales and marketing presentation for Suboxone and Vivitrol and whatever. So what have we been able to get out of the pharmaceutical companies if they're going to be selling more of their drug, these drugs that have already made back all their research and development costs, and they only cost a fraction of what they charge to actually manufacture? What have they been able to add to this to make it more affordable for you and I and society to pay for all of this great care?
Ken, I'm going to ask you to answer this question.
Well, you know, from my standpoint as the director of addiction treatment program in the inner city of Baltimore, you know, I'm just so pleased to have various treatments from non-medication-based to being able to use medications as tools. And these are, you know, saving lives every day. This is the business that I'm doing right now. I'm not personally, you know, working with the pharmaceutical companies, so it's hard for me to answer specifics for your questions. But you know, I think that making these medications available is critically important. The you know, these medications aren't actually available in many states still. There's just some, you know, news out of Illinois recently that where, you know, the coverage for methadone treatment is limited. You know, there's areas, for example, in the rural areas across the country where there's an underavailability of, you know, any of these medications or of treatment in general, including these sorts of medications. You know, if these medications had been, if and when at some point in the future they're reimbursable, then treatment programs can open, and, you know, once they're built, then people will come, and more lives will be saved.
Let me just add parenthetically that both methadone and buprenorphine are generic medications. Vivitrol is brand medication, but the other two are generic. Colin, do we have another question?
Yes, we do. Going now to our next caller. This is the line of Diane. Diane, please go ahead.
Hi. This question might not seem quite relevant to the presentation, which was very helpful in some ways. Not much mention of family. I'm an internist in California, and I deal with mostly all population of substance use disorder patients.
I'm going to ask both Susan and Ken to respond.
What is the end point? I have several.
Susan, why don't you go first?
I just got a logistics question, actually, about the co-op model.
Colin, do we have
a lot
another
of PCPs, obviously,
caller?
You know, are contracted with.
Yes, we do. Go into the line
plans
of Nick. Nick, please go ahead.
Most plans rarely contract with OTPs. I think some, for some reason, having to do with our employee makeup and maybe ratio of unlicensed to licensed personnel. But under the co-op model, I'm curious how the billing would work. Would the PCP bill the OTP, and then the PCP gets reimbursed from the commercial insurance provider, or how would that work?
So in terms of treatment for in an opioid treatment program, that would need to be reimbursed, or the patient would pay out of pocket. For in some states, it might be that if it's not a reimbursable service, that might be allowed to be treated under the block grant. So it's a problematic sort of situation. You know, I'd love to hear about creative sorts of solutions to those sorts of things. I think ultimately, though, we need to decide that this is a necessary treatment, and that, you know, not providing disorders life-saving treatment, especially during a time of when people are dying of opioid overdoses, is just wrong.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just wondering if efforts might be better focused, because the funding is an issue in, I'm sure, every state. And here in Arizona, I know New York can actually now get reimbursed for dispensing Suboxone from OTPs, and that's pretty rare, and I know most states are making a push for that. But this co-op model, it sounds good, but I think the existing OTP model where Suboxone physicians are actually working within the OTPs, you know, moonlighting in our facilities and prescribing from our facilities, also seems like a really viable option because from what I understand, a lot of providers don't use their X number because really they're scared of dealing with the DEA. They're not used to it. And additionally, they don't want that patient population incorporated into their, you know, their private practice. And so having providers prescribe out of OTPs, I think that makes a lot of sense. And obviously that X number would go away if we were dispensing from OTPs and getting reimbursed for it, which is the big challenge, obviously.
Yeah, Nick, that's a great model too. That's the great thing about this is that there's a lot of different types of models that that can be established in different areas depending on what the logistics are. In the case of prescribing through an X number for somebody that's in an OTP or, in a drug abuse treatment center, it doesn't have to be an OTP, that's great. I could do that as well here in my program, but, you know, it's an issue of some manpower issue. But also I've learned to really like having providers in the community to doing this for a couple of reasons. One is that it's encouraging more providers to be doing this, and so when somebody is identified by their primary care provider and they're already doing this sort of work because they ported through these sorts of integrative models, then they can go ahead and either start or refer to treatment. The other thing is that I like the concept of having the connection between this medication, where there's a motivation for the person to continue to take this medication, along with their mental or their physical health. And I think it gets them to continue to come to treatment. And while they're getting those prescriptions, the doctor also has the opportunity to see how their chronic, often chronic and co-occurring psychiatric and somatic disorders are doing.
Hi, my name is Stephanie. I'm a certified health worker, certified recovery specialist, graduated from Aspen here in Indianapolis, Indiana. I guess I have some questions in regards to what, let's say somebody had developed an addiction to Suboxone, and, which I've seen happen amongst people that I've known. Where would you go from there? I mean, from my standpoint, I would suggest counseling to be at the forefront of importance in recovery, possibly a life coach, any kind of counseling, you know, because medication only goes so far, but, you know, it's an everyday, I mean, you have to put as much into your recovery as you did when you were actively in addiction. So what would be the protocol on somebody that was abusing one of these medication treatments?
Would you please answer?
Yeah, I can go ahead. So first of all, I completely agree with you that counseling should be a mainstay of all of these sorts of treatments. None of these medications are silver bullets. And, you know, in a good adaptive step care model, we're connecting those sorts of counseling services along with the medication so that we're motivating attendance to these sorts of services. If somebody, let's say in terms of buprenorphine, if they're abusing buprenorphine, then in their assessment, we need to find out what's going on with them. Is it just that they haven't had treatment available to them, and as long as they're using, you know, this particular, let's say, reasonable amount of this drug that they happen to, you know, buy on the street, that they've otherwise been stable in terms of their opiate use? It might be that by having it prescribed at that point in time that they are stabilized very easily. in my experience, somebody who's doing that, they're likely also using some other drugs as well, and then so that's where the counseling and, you know, potentially medications, let's say if they're using alcohol as well, to place. Everything comes down to having, you know, doing a good comprehensive evaluation when the person's coming in, figuring out what they need, and I'm having a discussion of the pros and cons of all of the types of treatments and levels of treatments that can be offered, and then coming to a decision together about what to do. But I don't think that we should just be throwing medications at everybody as a solution, that we should be looking at, you know, treatment and recovery as a comprehensive and long-term sort of issue.
Thank you.
Sue, anything you want to add?
No, actually, Ken covered it wonderfully.
Well, I think that's why we call it medication-assisted treatment, with the emphasis on the assisted as much as on the medication. Well, with that, Colin, I'm going to ask that we close the lines, and we would be very pleased to hear from people who weren't able to get their questions answered, or if you think there are some other issues that could be addressed through this kind of presentation. There are, of course, many models, including the model in Vermont, which is primarily a rural state and grappling with serious problems that they've addressed through a fairly unique approach. So we'd be glad to hear from people. June, I don't know if there's a good way to do that, but certainly you can contact ONDCP or SAMHSA and let us know if there are other issues that you would like to hear about.
Right. And Bob, I wanted to say a couple of things. First, thanks to all of our presenters and our webinar participants for making a very rich and informative discussion. I also want to mention that the slides will be made available to all the registered participants, whether they actually ever logged in or not. And also, the webinar will be available on the ONDCP webpage starting next week. So it will be more, you know, available for others to go in and see. So I think with that, that's all we have time for. So thanks, everybody, and for all of your input, and have a great day. Thanks so much.
Thank you as well. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye. Thanks.